shine very brightly, but they do not produce their light due to shocks for a long time in their life. During first years, they produce light due to radioactive decays. But there are some very luminous, very powerful events like type 2N supernovae, some other supernovae, which shine, we believe, mostly due to shocks during the first year. And of course, shocks are vital for explanation of X-ray luminosity on much, much lower orders of magnitude, lower scale, but for much longer time, for thousands, hundreds of thousands of years in supernova remnants. And we see those shocks here and some stuff inside. But I want to explain how a star can lose a lot of its kinetic energy in the first year, in the first months of its life due to shocks. So standard order of events in a supernova, as Sergei Moisenko told us yesterday, is probably core collapse in the majority of events. Sometimes in type 1a supernova, we do not have collapse, and probably in some of extremely luminous ones, like, and sometimes in probably pure instability supernovae, most luminous supernovae, we have pure explosion without our core collapse. But majority of supernovae have core collapse. We see neutron stars from many supernovae, historical supernovae. And this should be accompanied by neutrino, gravitational wave signal. Neutrinos were detected only once, a quarter of a century ago, a handful of neutrino events. And gravitational waves are not yet detected. Then we have shock creation. And this shock propagates inside the star, produces entropy, heat, and then subsequently we see the light of those shocks. And eventually, depending on the size of a star, in a few minutes or many hours or even days, these shocks arrive to the surface, and then we see that brilliant event, shock breakout. And if we have now, say, maybe Vladimir knows better, maybe 20 core collapses per second in our universe up to redshift 2, and maybe 60 to the particle horizon, 60 core collapses a second in our universe, then there is no hope to observe those neutrino events at such rate, maybe once per century. Gravitational wave signal, next generation, which is, well, Lisa is now killed for a while, I don't know. When we will see gravitational waves, but with a Subaru telescope, and just in its field, we can discover from 3 up to 20, or hyper supreme camera maybe, but current can 3-5 events per night, no problem. We just got a few days ago time, 2 nights with Subaru telescope. I hope to report to you our success or failure after November. But the failure may be related only to weather, because actually it's inevitable. We have the statistics of supernovae in each galaxy. We know this for sure. If we just look into the field, we'll have observable shock breakouts. It's an electromagnetic signal, very robustly predicted by us, by others. So after that, we have a real supernova event, diffusion of photons, cooling of ejecta, and in tens, hundreds, thousands of years, the shock interaction with surrounding. But normal supernovae produce ordinary weak supernova, so to say, which produce like on the order of a few percent of the luminosity of our galaxies, so to say. But some of them produce light for weeks or months on the order of our galaxy, or even more luminous in photons and visible light. So the idea is very old, so to say, as far as I know. Maybe somebody else has than I know better how Russian works, and this was suggested by my colleagues Eric Grasberg, who is in Riga, Latvia now, and Dmitry Nadezhin. So they explained why one of type 2N supernovae, 83K, Nikolai Chugai probably will tell you much more about type 2N supernova next talk, but they suggested that the properties of that event can be explained if we have a succession of two nearby events. The first weak explosion, a lot of mass nearby of the supernova within 2-4 months, they suggested. But this may happen within a few years before the real supernova explodes. So then we have a lot of matter to interact. Billion of times higher particle density, and then shock will lose its kinetic energy much faster and will produce much more light, and they explained in this way those properties. But, well, this is another old idea. It's just my personal advertisement. I just looked into archive of today. All people cite a paper by Eichler, 1989, about merging neutron stars as a source of gamma ray bursts. Now we understand the shortcut, but this is my idea. I cannot stop. Since here are gamma ray bursts people, they do not know probably this word, but you can easily find it now in ADS. And Eichler actually used our scenario. I cannot help without a reference. So, the first messengers of explosion, as I told already, may be neutrinos. I put question mark here because it's so hard to detect them. Gravitational waves, radio waves may be possible as a shaking of a star or some. But shock breakout, I can put here exclamation mark, not question mark, because it must be observed. Well, I will not go into details of supernova classification, not important for us, but what are most interesting to us here are those. This is from a paper of Turato. But what is most interesting for us are those peculiar 1BC supernovae and type 2Ns. I will concentrate today mostly on hydrogen-less supernovae and hypernovae as well. Their light may be due to those unusual external conditions. So we have a set now of very luminous type 2N supernovae. This is from this paper by Drake 2 years ago. And the one we have studied with Stan Woosley and Alexander Heger is this 06GY. Its luminosity is on the order of our galaxy. So it's two orders of magnitude more luminous than a standard type 2P supernova in ordinary visible light, 100 times more powerful. And if we want to show here, say, 87A, which was minus 16, it would be somewhere here. You see, it was visible by naked eye from nearby galaxies. It's very weak, actually, absolutely. So it's a real challenge how we explain those extremely powerful events, which I term hyper-supernovae, and normally people use them superluminous supernovae, SLSN, so they're called now. Remember, this supernova, I show it, compare it later with ordinary hypernovae. Those are even much brighter than hypernovae. And what we try to model now is those H-poor superluminous supernovae. This is from the paper by Quimby in Nature. And again, the same level of absolute power and long duration, and most probably those events are explained by long-living radiative shocks. So what is the relation to the topic of your workshop here? Of course, people already mentioned that at least some of GRBs are correlated with supernovae. Not all of them, it's also an enigmatic problem, but some of them correlate. And those superluminous supernovae can be probes of early universe. This is also very important, exactly the subject of your grant project, because they can be observed with James Webb's Tapes telescope very easily up to redshifts 30. Very first stars would produce peer instability supernovae, we believe. It's a hard problem to detect because at this redshift, the light curve will not have a duration of 1 year. It would have a direction of 30 years. Yeah. So it would be hard to tell if you say a supernova, just a newborn galaxy. So, but at the moment of the growth, if you have a few years of time of James Webb telescope, then you can tell, okay, this is a supernova coming up. And another interesting thing, just methodologically, we can develop those sophisticated codes, as Hiro told us, but we have to check on something. If you won't explain very luminous GRBs, afterglows, you need to check on something you easily observe. And people observe those in abundance now. So we want to understand physics of shocks, the numerical modeling. There is plenty of papers, books, classical books. I will not go into details of the radiative shocks. They are classified mostly by Zeldovich, Reiser, and their book, but there are different stages of criticality of shock waves. We have to do with supercritical shock waves. Moreover, even more than supercritical, they are called radiation dominated, because what people call supercritical shock, this means that the flow of heat, of photons, they raise the temperature before the front of a real viscous front of the shock, they raise the temperature to the final Hugo Neau Rankine temperature. But then in a supercritical shock wave, there is still some jump of density. What we really have in radiation-dominated shocks, the disappearance of the jump. If we have a photon radiation-dominated plasma, then we have a standard compression of density, the jump of density in the shock of a factor of 7 for radiation-dominated adiabatic exponent. But this is only for an adiabatic shock. For radiating and almost isothermal shocks, the compression may be orders of magnitude higher because we have a kind of, may have a kind of isothermal shock wave. And radiation-dominated shock is nice. There is no jump in density. All momentum is transferred by photons. All structure is determined by photons. It's easier to model. You do not need any artificial viscosity, no Godunov solvers, nothing. You just need good radiative transport. What accuracy you model radiative transport, the same accuracy you model the structure of the shock. So this is important for computer people. Okay, this I told already, no time to go in many details. This is the critical condition found by some people in classified reports. When the radiation pressure is higher by a factor of 4 or maybe 8 in some other papers, then you have a disappearance of a viscous jump. It's like in cosmic ray dominated supernova remnants, for example. In any relativistic plasma, the jump disappears. What we can predict about the shocks inside supernova, those are rather old simulations for 87A done by me. Inside the star, here I plot velocity in thousands of kilometers per second, and here I have the mass which remains in solar masses in logarithmic scale, which remains towards the surface of the star. So, well, this is deep inside the star, the shock is relatively weak, and this is time in seconds from core collapse. A couple of hours after core collapse, the shock approaches the surface. Inside the star, it's adiabatic, so we have a sharp front. And when we approach the surface, we see that photons start leaking out. They accelerate those layers, and the form of the velocity profile changes. This is the moment of shock breakout, when photons go out. And there is a very simple criterion when this optical depth is the order of speed of light divided by the shock front velocity, then you have this event or shock breakout. Probably the first one to find this criterion was Oyama in Japan, 1963. And when we reach this condition, we see that acceleration of the shock in outer layer stops and photons break out. The same plot, but with optical depth, logarithm of optical depth. We see that optical depth 10, exactly as predicted by Oyama's formula, we have this shock breakout. And if we look into temperature, deep inside the star, it is very high, but when we approach the surface and this shock breakout, it's on the order of million of kelvins, so it should produce only very soft X-ray, 10% of KeV, contrary to many other older computations which predicted billions of kelvins here maybe. And it's very important to explain why we know this, a few words maybe said later. And after we have the shock breakout, we have a burst in luminosity, we have a peak in the color temperature, and then everything decays. For 100 of seconds, supernova 87A was more luminous than our galaxy. What we have now about those hyper supernova, though this luminosity on this level continues for weeks and months, and this is the challenge. If we have different radius of supernovae, larger is the radius, a bit smaller is luminosity. Of course, the light curve is wider due to time delay correction. Temperature at the shock front goes down. But what is very interesting here, if we look into the profiles of density, we see the formation of spike in density. There is a very thin shell of matter forming. The mass of this shell is the same mass we had at shock breakout, like 1 millionth of solar mass, 10 to minus 6 of solar masses in this supernova. But if we have a huge supernova, a huge surrounding matter, the mass in this shell, those are our recent simulations for those hyper supernovae. The mass in this very dense shell can be 1, 2, 5, 10 solar masses. So it's a huge mass now propagating, and this is the cause of a huge luminosity. We can follow this evolution, and those long-living dense shells are the cause of the luminosity. So a few words on what we're doing. This is a very long formula with all relativistic corrections for radiative transfer in a co-moving frame. This was coded by Alexei Tolstov, who is here now, my former student. And in principle, here is Lorentz factor gamma. The code works now up to gamma almost 1,000. So in principle, it was already used for gamma ray burst afterglows. But now we have only one diversion of hydrodynamics coupled to transport. But it's a very complicated problem already. It's more than 3D problem, because we have one dimensions for hydrodynamics and two for radiative transfer, for energy angle of photons. And all dimensions are different in treatment, not like ordinary 3D hydro. each x, y, z, all the same. You have the same code for everything. Here, for each dimension in momentum, angle, and hydrodynamic quantities, you have different approximation. This is a high-order implicit scheme, so a very complicated code. And that is why it's not so easy to do. It's multidimensional, but we're beginning working on that with Alexei and Hiro. And to model this, we used our two algorithms. I don't go into details. Stella is very old. Its age is like 87A, a quarter of a century, but of course it's updated each year. And here is a comparison of our old predictions with Stella, the solid line, and dotted dashed line those full relativistic corrections computed by Alexei, this new code, RADA. And we see that there is a small difference in power, but corrections only smear here. The same number of photons is produced and detected, so it's okay. If we look into a shock breakout, how it looks like nearby, it's like in gamma ray bursts, afterglows. There is a typical ring of brightness because of light travel time corrections at the shock breakout. And if we look at those extremely huge and luminous supernovae like O6 Joy, we have again a ring, but a different nature. This is not a light travel time correction, just shining dense shell. The shell I have shown to you. If we could resolve, then we should see something like this, a quarter of a star, of course. So it's like an extremely young supernova remnant. So I have mentioned already that other people predicted very high temperature. There were ideas by Colgate that we can produce gamma ray bursts when they were believed to be inside our galaxy, that shock breakouts could give us gamma ray bursts. But there was a very good and detailed PhD dissertation by Weaver and published in Astrophysical Journal Supplement 1976. It's known by JRB community, but somehow ignored by supernova community. A very important paper. In his dissertation, he has shown that temperature should be low, cannot be so high as to be in gamma. It produces only soft X-rays. And the problem was that he has taken into account so-called double Compton effect or Compton effect of second order, which is very important indeed. And as we found with Alexei, it can really reduce temperature by orders of magnitude. So I here show some spectra of our runs now extended almost to gamma ray region. If we look at 87A, we see two spikes in temperature. Notice huge scale and logarithm scale here. Here it is 10 orders of magnitude, so here is 8 orders of magnitude. So we can see some hard X-rays, but extremely weak. It's just transparency of the outer layers of a star to X-ray. So when you see the deep shockwave, you have some X-rays, but outside they become very soft. Here is this black body fit. So the dash line is a code that tries to find a black body fit. I cannot make page up here. So you see, this is just our code. Here is a nice black body fit. It ignores this since there are many orders of magnitude lower. Optical luminosity is here, you know, it's a fraction of electron volts. Here it's very high. In principle, you reach 10 to 45 for 100 seconds. Yeah. Oh, no, no, not, not in optical. 45 is bolometric, but in optical it's relatively weak, yeah, three orders lower, like here. So if we ignore that effect, which was taken into account in that nice dissertation, then we can get easily 10 billion kelvins, so it's extremely good, hard X-ray. But in reality, if you introduce that effect, which is 10 to minus 5, but we put artificially 10 to minus 6 of standard Thomson scattering, we dramatically decrease, you see the change of the scale, two orders of magnitude lower temperature and much softer spectrum. Why is it possible? Just because we have huge optical depth to scattering, and optical depth is like 1,000. All Compton effects are optical depth squared, so you have optical depth 1,000,000. So if you have this negligible true absorption in opacity, then everything is thermalized, and you do not produce those nice tail like Blandford Pain predicted. Their effect would not work if you take into account this small correction. Nothing happens. So no hard X-rays.
Is it right to say that the radiation
emitted
shock
idea by
the best approximation?
Yes, in some sense. And the thermal emission of this shock is a very good approximation, yeah. No non-thermal tails are produced in this way. Now I say only a few words about this very interesting effect in this galaxy, a factory of supernovae. This X-ray flash was observed by an accident by Alicia Soderberg, but we have this event with the properties, the hardness of the spectrum, and total energy of photons in exact accordance with our simulations of shock breakouts. But it's rather long. We predict a few seconds, maximum 10 seconds, but it was hundreds of seconds. This was a problem. We can explain it only by a cloud surrounding it. The problem was that actually supernova 1BC type, more or less normal, weak supernova was discovered later. You see logarithmic scale in days here, and its stellar magnitude. This was this X-ray here. And but there were some claims, say by Li Xin Li, that actually there was no shock breakout due to a two-temperature black body spectrum, which he found. But actually, there is no problem in his fit. So those are two lines fitting the spectrum of X-ray with two black bodies. But you see, it just repeats what we have found in our shock breakout computation. So his argument now. Previous plots were for 87A, now for 1B supernova. We again have much harder, much more powerful, but two spikes in black body, harder spectrum, but in exact accordance, what was observed. I mean, qualitatively, because quantitatively we must surround this with a huge cloud. And we could apply, there are also two shocks, shock breakouts observed in type 2 supernova is high redshifts already, I don't remember numbers, 1.7 and 2 by two groups, Ghezari, Shavinsky, and they observed those. You see noisy signals, but one can find some rise in luminosity. And if we compare with our stellar computations, which were done by Nozomu Tominaga, who is now in Kobe University, with our code, you see here for, say, for 2 days, our prediction in continuum and here. So it's a very good agreement to what was observed. So we believe in our codes, we believe in understanding, and that is why I'm ready to apply this code to explanation of those most luminous supernovae ever observed, because what we need in some cases, we see if we surround a source with some cloud, when we can change the properties of it. And this way, I thought to model 06 GY when I came to Stan Woosley early in 07, and he had the same idea, would not know about Grasberg Nadezhdin, about Nikolai Chugai. He said he invented himself. I could hardly convince him to put those references in our paper. I don't know why. But it is cited in our Nature paper with Stan Woosley on 06 July. What they had with Alexander Heger was a really good, detailed evolutionary model, which was going to the region of peer instability supernovae, exploding and predicting its structure. And we could input in it our code and to predict the light curve of the supernova. So if we show fluxes of typical supernova, here is clearly seen that a factor of two in logarithm scale, a factor of 100 difference in fluxes, 06 GY, long duration, in comparison with the typical type 2 supernovae. Most scientific plot is here, and stellar magnitudes the same. So the idea to explain it, this one, and maybe more luminous, was to surround it, to eject matter in some way, to have several explosions, and then to explode more or less normal supernova inside it. So the total light is 10 to 51 ergs. Ordinary supernova produces 10 to 51 ergs in kinetic energy. Only in 100,000 years it is all emitted in X-rays, radio waves, cosmic rays. But this was emitting during 1 year, the similar amount. Not actually 10 to 51, maybe 30% of it, but it's really huge energy, two orders of magnitude larger than standard supernovae. So this is picture due to Nikolai Chugai, very nice illustration from our paper on supernova 94W in 2004, other Swedish colleagues mostly. So we have an ordering explosion in a kind of very dense envelope. Parameters of density and radius can be different in different supernovae, but Nikolai probably will explain in his talk more about that. But this cloud produces narrow line spectra. That is why those supernovae are called type 2N. This again from our paper, but my computation already, this dense shell, you see this isothermal shock wave, the jump of density, not a factor of 7, but a factor of 100,000 maybe, easily produced. And the mass here in this shell is almost one solar mass already. But how we can get those shells? There may be, this is an unsolved problem in stellar evolution. Okay. But in principle, what was the idea of Stan and Alex was to suggest so-called pulsational peer instability supernovae. Ordinary peer instability supernovae, very massive ones, they explode completely in one terrible explosion. But those intermediate masses, they can have several explosions in their computations, and it can be easily explained qualitatively. If anybody wants, I can explain on the blackboard later. But depending on the helium mass here or total mass there, one can predict the energy of explosion. This is from a review by Alex Heger and Stan Woosley 10 years ago. The amount of nickel mass, which can be huge if you have a really peer instability supernova. But if you have a pulsational peer instability, then there may be no nickel at all, but still extremely bright luminosity. For a classical peer instability, I have done my simulations for them very long ago when they were writing more than 10 years ago, but I don't know why they would not publish it, just presented at a couple of conferences. But now they published other simulations. I am showing them here. If we have this O6GY here, and we have a classical peer instability supernova, initially 250 solar mass, it's too much slow. It's really bright, really luminous, but too slow, rises later. And now they published that with another radiation code, but which is not hydrodynamic, but Dan Kazin. They published last year. And if you look into this light curve, it's almost the same as we found 10 years ago. But they have now much more models, and they show the same comparison with O6GY. It's much longer. But what is interesting for your project of finding star formation at very high redshifts, in their paper you can see they can predict those signals up to redshift 13 here, but James Webb telescope can go detect supernova 32. So here is actual limit. So really this can be up to redshift 20, 30. And you can probe early universe, not only with GRBs, but with those events, which are probably much better understood and probably will be discovered in much large numbers soon. But the physics of multiple explosion can be explained on those plots. There's a central density, central temperature track, many pulses, and peer instability is in this region. And we have first ejection with small velocity, this solid line is velocity, and the second ejection, which goes faster and then produces a lot of light. So this is a kind, I can call it a supernova repeaters. So there are several years between two flashes, and then can be death of the star, and gamma ray bursts probably here. There'll be many multiple explosions and so on. If we input this all into our code, we can produce powerful light, but not powerful enough. This is solid line, is what was taken from real evolutionary computation. To reproduce peak luminosity, I had to increase velocity by a factor of 2 by hand. And Stan said, okay, because there is chaotic behavior in his code, maybe this explosion is a factor of 2. This is just a standard supernova, so a factor of 3 larger than standard 3, 10 to 51 Earths. Just 3, 10 to 51. 3 foy or 3 beta, as we tell now. Then we can match the luminosity. Our modern computations are shown here, much better fits. And there are complicated structure of those dense shells colliding, luminosity growing, temperature is here. We will not go into details, but they grow, they produce those bright rings and huge luminosity. And final part of my talk is about those hydrogen poor supernovae, which are the same luminosity. The idea is the same. We do not have at hand any evolutionary model and no idea of that evolution, because here we do not have those huge masses. We do not need them, and we do not know what is exploding, actually. We know only surrounding masses should not be huge, like 5-6 solar masses, no hydrogen at all. The same idea, just input some matter surrounding it, and you get it. So here I show those typical type 1b hypernovae, so to say, this famous red 98BW, which was cited many times here, the phased gamma ray burst connection. It's a hypernova, and this one, 99E, is brighter already. But as I have shown already, it is here. It is the brightest of all hypernovae. It's very weak among those new ones. So that is why I call those ones hyper-supernovae. So analyst. But type 2, and the same level was for hydrogen-poor supernova. This is borrowed from this paper by Ofik. The idea is the same. We have some explosion, some wind, they take this density profile, but since this applies only for steady winds and we have not steady process, then power law can be quite different. We have a free parameter here, and we just play with parameters of that. And we can put almost zero velocity also, or even high velocity in the wind. And then different density profiles are tried. This function of mass, you see only 4, 5, 6 solar masses are needed outside, and we have a lot of light. No, there's Elena Sorokina has computed now maybe 200 models, different parameters, and we have those very luminous bright events very easily with relatively small masses. Yes. Now I just quickly show many plots. So just in comparison with those Quimby-type supernovae, peak luminosity, typical scales are really easily reproduced, and this is no problem. But the ordinary explosion, 2-4 standard supernovae, not a hypernova explosion, only density and structure surrounding it. This is a few days ago done by Alexei with a relativistic code. Black line is stellar and colored lines with time lag corrections are radar. You see very good correspondence. So nickel is not important only on the tail if you want to input it. And we can compare with one of those powerful different models. You see the 3 BESA means 3 to 10 to 51 ergs. Small energy enough to reproduce observations. And this is an interesting event, an interesting model. We put similar energy into ejector and into the wind. High velocity in the wind means we have no narrow lines, contrary to type 2Ns. Still, if this mass is larger than internal mass, then velocity of internal mass is higher, and we can reproduce observations without narrow lines. This is most interesting in this work. Well, I have no time to show the applications of those extremely bright events to cosmology. Please believe me, we are preparing paper maybe tomorrow. Tomorrow here is conference. The day after tomorrow, I submit it to JET Letters, I hope, and we can use directly observation O6G1, already published observation without any ladder of cosmological distances, which I showed, directly using it as a primary distance indicator. I can obtain, of course, with huge error because of huge absorption here, I can obtain Hubble parameter like this, absolutely independently of all previous calibrations, any Phillips relations. Nothing is needed. Just one supernova. Please give us many more observations. Will give us new cosmology with those events. And finally, of course, everything is not so spherical as we want in our spherically symmetric simulation, because this is 130 solar mass star, which already started exploding in 19th century and may produce a brilliant supernova tomorrow, any day from now. But surrounding it, matter is very, very asymmetric. And there are some attempts to do 3D simulations without any transport, and they show that basic model is correct. The shells remain very spherical, very weak development of instabilities. And here I can stop that radiating shock. Some more most probable sources of those luminous events, like type 2N and hydrogen pore, and we can develop new cosmology. And the energy needed in hydrogen pore supernovas in this range, those masses and radius. So narrow lines are not necessary. They may be there, but not necessary. And of course, there are many questions: evolution, observations, and theory. And thank you very much.